ओके तेज, सो लेट्स स्टार्ट विद क्वेश्चन नंबर 8. सो आई थिंक वी हैड डिस्कस क्वेश्चन नंबर 8 लास्ट टाइम. दीदी, और एटलीस्ट आई टोल्ड यू सम मेथड ऑफ सॉल्विंग इट. एनीवे, सो लेट्स गो थ्रू इट अगेन. सो क्वेश्चन 8 इज गिविंग अस दीज टू इन्फॉर्मेशन दैट, सो दीदी, यू आर हैविंग सम प्रॉब्लम विद सॉल्विंग द इक्वेशंस और in question number 8. Oh, okay. Assignment 4 we will do at a later time. We have to discuss few more things before that. From assignment 3, then anything before question number 11? Any doubt before question number 11? Question 6, okay. Okay. So Karan, I think 6 also we had discussed last time. Anyway, let me quickly take you through that. In question 6, A plus B is given to you in vector form. Okay. 10 I cap or whatever. And A minus B is given to you. Okay. 10 root 3 j cap. So what you do is you add the two equations. Add these two equations and you'll get 2a is 10 I cap plus 10 root 3 j cap. So from that you can calculate the vector e. And similarly, if you subtract the two equations, you'll get 2b. And from that you can calculate b. And then from that you can calculate magnitude of a and b. And anything else that is required. Okay, you can calculate these things. So that is the method. Okay, you will find it in the recording of last lecture, Karan. So if you go through it, you can understand that. Okay. Now let us come to question 11 then. Okay. Question 11 also, I kind of remember we had discussed. So anyway, what you do in question 11 is you express all those vectors in component form. So all the vectors that are given to us, which are namely three vectors, A, B, and C. Now, E is at 60 degrees like this, and its magnitude is 10. So in component form, E will become 5 I cap. Plus 5 root 3 j cap. Now similarly, the vector b is like this, and this angle is 60 and its magnitude is 10. So the angle with the x-axis is 120. So the vector b will become minus 5 I cap plus 5 root 3 j cap. And the vector c, though, is directly along the x-axis and its magnitude is 10. So the vector C just becomes 10 I cap. Now just check all the operations in the options which are given. So for example, option A says A and B are about A plus B. So you calculate what is A plus B over here. So from this you can see A plus B. Just add these two. So 5 minus 5, 0, and 5 root 3 plus 5 root 3. So it becomes 10 root 3 j cap. So you can see that A plus B is 10 root 3 j cap. So it has a magnitude of 10 root 3 and direction along y axis. And therefore it is perpendicular to E, is perpendicular to C. Anyway, that is not asked over here. It's just along x-axis or y-axis. That's not required. So anyway, both the options A and B, you can see are correct from that. then the third option is asking you about a minus b. So calculate the difference of a minus b from here. So just subtract the two. So you get 5 minus 5, that is 10 I cap. Okay, plus 5 root 3 minus 5 root 3, so that's 0. Okay. Okay, let me just check that out. Okay. So A minus B should become how much? It should become 10 I cap. So option C becomes wrong. And option D is also correct. Okay, so if there's some mistake in the answer key, just make the correction. Instead of B, it should be C. So the incorrect option is C. Okay, C is the incorrect option. Okay. What about 12th? You got that? No, I don't think so. Anyway, let us see. 12th ka answer kya hona chahiye? E plus B is how much? It is 10 root 3 J cap. So when you add that with C, it should give you it should give you 10 root 3, 10 I cap plus 10 root 3 J cap. So it should give you 20. So 11th answer, 12th answer B is correct. Okay, 12th answer is correct, beta. Just in 11th, change the answer. 11th, the correct answer should not be B. It should be C. Okay, you see in 12th, A plus B plus C is 10 I cap plus 10 root 3 J cap. So its magnitude will in fact become 20. Just take the mod of this, you'll get 20. So B option is correct. Okay, that's given in the answer key. And 13 also I think should be correct. Okay. Was A minus B was how much we saw? A minus B was 10 I cap, no? So A minus B se agar hum C ko subtract kar liye, so we will get a null vector. Okay. So which one should be the null vector? B plus C minus A. So B option should be correct. Okay, so you can say B plus C minus A is 0 from this now. So 13th also, B option is correct. 12th also, B option is correct. Null vector is 0, beta. Okay, just do this operation, see. E minus B is 10 I cap, na? So if I subtract C from that, I will get 0. So you can see that E minus B minus C is 0. So that is the same thing as saying B plus C minus A is 0. I mean, 0 is the null vector here, because left hand side is a vector. So right hand side cannot be equated to 0. It has to be equated to null vector. That is a vector of 0 magnitude. Okay, understood now. So that's also correct in the answer key. Yes, B is given. Okay, now let's check out 14th. Now 14 mein kya keh raha hai, A plus B plus C makes an angle of how much? So how much was A plus B plus C? We had seen earlier. A plus B plus C was 10 I cap plus 10 root 3 J cap. So the angle with the X axis is tan inverse of root 3. So it's at 60 degrees with respect to X axis. So that should be the correct answer. So A should be the correct answer. So 14th A is given, yes. Okay. And 15th, I think we had discussed 15th or not. 15th is, by the way, very simple. Are 14 beta, I've just done it for you. Na? A plus B plus C is this vector. So iska angle kitna hota hai with respect to X axis. Any vector's angle with the x-axis is tan inverse of the y component divided by x component. This formula you've seen na before. So tan inverse of 10 root 3 by 10 is how much? Got it? Na? Simple. Okay. 15th ho gaya, people. it's very easy. In 15th, you have to just equate the magnitude of that vector with 13. You know, so you will get 5 square plus y square is 13 square. Yeah, so that's done. Okay, good. All right, so now we will move on with some more concepts. Then, okay, because we need some more problem solving methods and all that to solve additional questions before we come to more things in vectors, namely three-dimensional components and things like that. But before we come to three-dimensional component algebra, so far we are seeing two-dimensional component algebra, that is the coordinate system. But we'll also see assignment four doubts, Peter. As I was just telling you, assignment four we will do after discussing some more methods, okay, which is why I have not sent assignment four to you people as yet. Okay, we will discuss, don't worry. Yeah, resultant sum, some addition of vectors, these all mean the same things. The term resultant on its own also means sum. Resultant sum, okay. Sum, then addition, okay. These all mean one and the same thing. They are vector addition. That operation. Okay, now let's come back to some more methods in methods and theorems about vector addition and vector subtraction. So yeah, so the term resultant is always used like that, okay? So additional theorems for sum and difference. Of vectors. So we'll start this by understanding something called the parallelogram law of vector addition and subtraction. So what the parallelogram law does is it combines the two triangle laws. Okay. Sum and difference. So let's examine how it does that. So we had seen that if we are given two vectors, let's say two arbitrary vectors A and B are given to us like this, such that this angle is some theta. Okay. Then how to calculate the sum? We arrange them into this manner, head to tail. We join the two vectors head to tail. Or you can say we rearrange the vectors head to tail. And this here, this becomes the resultant sum of the vectors. So A plus B is also called the resultant of the two vectors, and this angle was called alpha. Whereas if we want to find the difference of the two vectors, what we used to do, we used to take the vector E and then we used to take the vector minus B. So minus B would be the vector of same magnitude as B but opposite in direction. So minus B would become a vector like this. It would be a vector whose magnitude is B only but whose direction is opposite. So this exterior angle here was 180 minus theta, because the vector B was making an angle theta. So this angle was theta. So this angle becomes 180 minus theta. And then the sum of A with the vector minus B, that was how we understood the difference of the two vectors. And of course, we had the formula to calculate each of these, which we had derived from trigonometry. So for example, for the difference of two vectors, the formula we had is that magnitude of A minus B was root of A square plus B square minus 2AB cos theta. All this you know, I'm just repeating. And you had beta was tan inverse of B sine theta upon A plus, sorry, A minus B cos theta. So these are things that you are very much familiar with. Now today we'll see a good sort of additional theorem where both these triangle laws are combined into one law, and that is called the parallelogram law. Okay, so this is something that you have seen. You're familiar with the two triangle laws. So these are triangle laws. Okay. Now next we will see how we write out the parallelogram law. So in the parallelogram law, what we do is we construct, the first step is construct a parallelogram using vectors A and B. So how we do that is that we draw the vectors A and B from a common origin or common source point. So instead of drawing them head to tail, we will draw the two vectors from the same origin. So if we have drawn vector A from here, we will draw the vector B also from the same origin point instead of drawing them head to tail. So now those two vectors will be drawn in this manner. This is the vector B, this is the vector A. This is the angle theta between them. Okay, then so this is the first step, okay, to construct the parallelogram. Draw the vectors A and B from the common origin. Okay, then draw the parallel sides. Okay, adjacent to them. And complete a parallelogram. So we'll draw another side adjacent to B, parallel to A, like this. So this should be a line which is parallel to the direction of A. This and this are parallel. And similarly, adjacent to A, we'll draw a line which is parallel to B. So that line looks like this. And wherever they intersect, that becomes the vertex. So that becomes our parallelogram. So this is the first thing. We construct the parallelogram in this manner. Okay, so we can see that again in this parallelogram, this exterior angle is also theta. Okay. Now, next step is the primary diagonal. Okay, that is the diagonal from the common origin to opposite vertex. Ye jo diagonal banayenge, this becomes the resultant sum. What happened, Tej? There are no other two vectors. There are only A and B. These are parallel sides. I have clearly mentioned over here. Draw parallel sides adjacent to the two vectors A and B. Okay. So this is just a line which is parallel, you'll understand clearly. सो अब ये जो डायगनल है फ्रॉम द ओरिजिन टू द ऑपोजिट साइड, दिस वन फ्रॉम द कॉमन ओरिजिन टू द ऑपोजिट साइड, दिस डायगनल नाउ रिप्रेजेंट्स द सम. ओके, एंड सिमिलरली द सेकेंडरी डायगनल Similarly, the secondary diagonal which is the diagonal from the head of vector A or let's say head of B to head of A, okay, this vector is the diagonal from the head of this one to the head of this one. This one will represent the difference. Okay. So this secondary diagonal is the difference A minus B. Okay, so just note down this till here, then I'll understand, then I explain to you how this actually comes from the two triangles. Okay. So you can actually skip writing this part because triangle law you're already familiar with. You can skip this part if you like. But the lower part, no, which I'm going to parallelogram law. So step by step you write down. Yes, Itanju, please tell me what do you want. Please message me whatever. So then what do you want to say now? Yeah, I'm coming to the derivation, Kunal. Okay. So these two steps you write down, rather these three steps. Yeah, Mayak, the triangle laws you have written down before, so you need not rewrite them. Just concentrate on this part now, the parallelogram part. Yeah, Itanshu, that is fine. There's no problem.
Okay. So now let us see. Yeah, just hold on, I'll explain everything. Okay. Now we'll see how this one figure combines the two triangle laws. Now how it does that. So what is happening here is that, let's go over the steps again. So what we do is, first step, we draw the vectors A and B from a common origin. So pehla step bhi hai, we have drawn vectors A and B both from the common origin. The next step is we draw sides which are parallel to respectively A and B. Okay. And complete this parallelogram. Now the second step after completing the parallelogram is that when we draw the primary diagonal from the origin to this side, our parallelogram law is telling us that this diagonal actually represents the sum. So let's understand how it represents the sum, because let us compare this with our triangle law. Now in the triangle law, for the sum of two vectors, what was the construction we used to do? If you just recall, you just do it on this side here. So take vector A first, okay, and then we would add vector B, but from the head of vector A. We would draw them head to tail like this. So vector A, vector B, this angle here would be theta. Okay. And then we would say that, okay, the third side of the triangle, which was the origin of vector A to the head of vector B, that represents the sum. Now if you look very closely, these two figures are identical in the sense that, if you look at this, this diagonal is dividing this parallelogram into two halves. Okay. Now, this triangle is the same as this triangle. They are identical triangles. So that is why I'm saying that the parallelogram law actually combines the two simpler laws. This triangle is contained within this triangle over here. So that is the logic of this, and that is why the formula for A plus B will be the same that we got from the derivation of the earlier one. It's ultimately is the same triangle, but it's contained within the parallelogram. So mod of A plus B will be root of A square plus B square plus 2AB cos theta, and alpha will be tan inverse of B sine theta upon A plus B cos theta. If you see, these two triangles are exactly congruent. Okay, understood this point? So that's the first thing. Now, the primary diagonal is the sum of A and B. How that is happening, that is like this. Now similarly, okay, finish this first. Okay, so I hope this comparison between the parallelogram and this triangle is clear to all of you. Now, similarly, we want to understand why the secondary diagonal represents the difference. So once again, you compare the parallelogram, but this time with the secondary diagonal drawn, because we're going to concentrate on that one, and compare it with the triangle law for the difference of two vectors. And you will see something very similar happens. Now the secondary diagonal here is this one, from the head of B to the head of A. And this is supposed to represent A minus B. And this angle is supposed to represent beta. Okay. Now look at the triangle law for the difference and you'll understand how it pertains to that. If this is the vector A, the same vector A I have drawn over here. Now to its head, I will add the vector minus B. Okay. So here, this angle is 180 minus theta. And you can see it's the same over here. This angle is 180 minus theta because this angle is theta. No? So this represents now E minus B. This angle represents beta. Okay, so exactly the same thing you are seeing here, that when you compare this triangle with this triangle, they are congruent triangles. Okay, and that is why this represents, okay, the same, the formula will be the same. Yeah, we will discuss that point, Itanju. Just finish with this first. Haan, the angle beta kaise aata tha na? You used to replace theta with 180 minus theta. Remember that triangle law method. So the angle beta is the angle made by the vector A minus B with respect to the vector E. So the derivation of triangle law for difference mein jaise kiya tha na angle beta ke liye. So the same thing applies over here also, because this triangle is ultimately congruent to this triangle. Understood, Karan? Danju is a parallelogram, so these opposite angles are obviously the same. The parallelogram has the property that the opposite sides are not only parallel but same in length. So this side is equal to this side and parallel. This side is equal to this side and parallel. And these two angles are the same, and these two angles are their complements. So that is part of the properties. Yeah. It's part of the properties of parallelogram. Right, so this is the parallelogram law itself. Okay, now one more thing here. Okay, the vector which is the secondary diagonal from head of B to head of A, that is equal to A minus B. And the reason for that is very simple. You can see by comparison of this triangle here and this triangle, A minus B is a vector in this sort of direction. See here, A plus of minus B. So A minus B is a vector in this sort of direction. It should be pointing from this point towards this point. So similarly here, when we draw the head from B to A, it's pointing from B's head to A's vector, A's head. So it represents which one? It represents A minus B. But similarly, if we draw it in opposite direction, okay, if we were to draw the vector like this now, from A's head to vector B's head, this will represent which one now? It will represent B minus A. It will represent opposite of that. So if we draw a vector like this now, we draw one from A's head to B's head. So we are going from A to B. So that will represent which one now? It will represent B minus A, which is minus of A minus B. Understand? They are equal and opposite vectors. So this vector is going in the opposite direction, but is of same magnitude. So this will represent B minus A. So this is because you understand that B minus A is negative of A minus B. So they are equal in opposite vectors. Okay, so remember in the parallelogram, when we draw the secondary diagonal, if we are going from B to A, then it represents A minus B. And if we are going from A to B, then it represents B minus A. Simple rule of thumb. Okay. From B to A is A minus B, and from A to B is B minus A. Okay, so this is all about the parallelogram law. I'll just once minimize you and take you through what we have discussed so far. So basically what we understood is that if we construct a vector parallelogram by drawing A and B from a common origin and then constructing the adjacent sides parallel, so this parallelogram is called the vector parallelogram of A and B, and its diagonals, they represent the sum and difference. the individual diagonals in turn, one of them represents the sum and one of them represents the difference. So which one represents the sum? The one which we call the primary diagonal, that is the one that is starting from the common origin and going to the opposite side. That one is called the primary diagonal, and that represents the sum of the two vectors. Whereas the other vector, which is going from head to head, that represents the difference. Now, while making the difference, if we're going from B to A, then the difference will be written as A minus B. If we are going from A to B, then the difference will be written as B minus A. Okay, so this is the simple principle to understand so far. Okay. Now, the reason why we discuss parallelogram laws separately, even though it's basically a combination of the two triangle laws, is because we can understand a lot of vector properties about sum and difference by just comparing the diagonals of the parallelogram. Okay. So a lot of properties of vectors can be understood from the parallelogram law. So properties, okay, inequalities, etc., can be understood directly cases, etc., from the parallelogram. No. So in this, the first thing we'll study is we'll take a rule, relook at triangle inequalities. Okay. So in general, remember that we know that magnitude of A plus B is less than equal to A plus B and greater than equal to the difference of A minus B. Okay. And this occurs when theta is equal to 0, and this occurs when theta is equal to 180 degrees. Similarly, we also know that A minus B can never be larger than the sum of the magnitudes and can never be less than the difference of the magnitudes. The only thing is this here occurs when theta is 180 and this here occurs when theta is equal to 0. Okay, so these are two inequalities that we are already aware of from the statement of triangle law. Okay. Now, what are the other things that we can develop using the parallelogram law? So let's understand that next. Okay. So let us look at one situation where theta is equal to 90. Okay. So when theta is equal to 90, what happens is our parallelogram is actually a rectangle. So what is the most important property of a rectangle? That is, diagonals are equal. And they are equal to how much? Root of A square plus B square. So theta equal to 90 corresponds to our parallelogram becoming a rectangle. Okay. And that corresponds to mod A plus B becoming equal to magnitude of A minus B, becoming equal to root of A square plus B square. And the two diagonals okay. Just keep this aside. This is what we've learned before. Okay. This is right now what we're learning next. Now, so just take a look at this and make sure you understand this. Okay. So it's obvious from the geometry also, and it's obvious from the formula of triangle law also. that if you put theta as 90 degrees, cos theta is 0. So obviously the formula becomes mod a plus b is equal to mod a minus b. Okay. And not only that, these two angles also become equal. Beta becomes equal to alpha. So this is one special case when theta is 90. Okay, so this is clear to all of you, that 90 degree case. Okay, now for a moment, just compare this with this next parallelogram, which I'm drawing on the side, where theta is not 90, but it's an acute angle. So take the same two vectors, but bend B a little bit on this side so that theta is becoming acute. So make it a parallelogram where theta is any arbitrary angle, but it's acute. That much we know for sure. So it's like this. Now, the moment you make theta acute, you observe something, your parallelogram bends from the rectangle in such a way that the primary diagonal, it gets elongated. Now, in comparison to the rectangle, you'll see in this parallelogram on the left is the first diagonal, the blue colored diagonal, which is the sum one, wo thoda elongate ho ja raha, it's getting stretched. Whereas the secondary diagonal is getting compressed a bit. Now, you can feel that when you change theta from 90, to theta being less than 90 degrees. Okay, you can see that thing happening. The moment it is acute, you will see that this one becomes larger. The primary diagonal becomes larger and the secondary diagonal becomes shorter. So that is an important inequality to remember, that when my theta is less than 90, what will happen? Which diagonal will be longer in length? This primary one. So that means in terms of vector, what we can say that mod of a plus b will be greater than mod of a minus b. So this is a very important special property to remember, which is very easy to remember from just visualizing the parallelogram, that the moment theta is acute, the diagonals are not equal and which one is getting longer, a plus b. So we can see that mod a plus b will be greater than mod a minus b the moment theta is acute. This is what will happen. Whereas the moment theta is 90, they will become equal. Okay. And also you can see that magnitude of a plus b will be greater than root of a square plus b square, because it's got stretched in comparison to this. Whereas the secondary diagonal, magnitude of a minus b will become less than root of a square plus b square. So when we are doing tricky questions, where we have to analyze the inequalities instead of the exact values, then this thing becomes very important to remember. These properties become very important to remember, these sort of inequalities. So easy way to remember the inequalities is just visualize the parallelogram. So the moment your angle theta is acute, you can visualize in your mind which diagonal is the longer one, the primary one, which is the shorter one, the secondary one. So these three inequalities come in place. This and this. Yes, that's why there will be a lot of questions which are based on inequalities. Okay. And you have to learn to do them without doing too much of calculation. So rather than use the formula of triangle law in those type of questions, it is easier to solve. It's faster, may be easier, but definitely faster to solve if we use this kind of principle, the geometrical kind of principles that I'm showing you over here. Okay, people, so hope this is clear, the theta acute case. Okay, now next we will compare this with a case where theta is obtuse. Let's look at a case where theta is obtuse. So now just imagine beta jada ho jayega actually. You can see this angle has become larger and alpha has become shorter. Okay, so that's also something. But anyway, now imagine that I'm, rotating the vector b the other way so that this angle is becoming more than 90. So then how will my parallelogram look? The rectangle will distort into a parallelogram. It will get out of shape from a rectangle. But into a parallelogram where now this is the case. ये ऐसा हो गया है, suppose. Becoming like this. So now which diagonal is getting stretched into a longer length? It's the secondary one, the red one. Which is getting compressed is the primary one. So when theta is greater than 90, that is, it's an obtuse angle. Now immediately you can see that what will happen here is that mod a plus b will become less than mod of a minus b, because you can visualize this and you can understand. So this thing becomes very easy to solve questions based on now. And along with that, you can see that this time a plus b's magnitude will become less than root of a square plus b square. Whereas a minus b's magnitude will become greater than root of a square plus b square. Okay, so these inequalities become important. Okay, another thing you can see in the comparison of these parallelograms is the angles. Now, if you see this angle beta over here in this one, you see it has got stretched compared to this one. And the angle alpha here has got compressed. So in this case, also what happens is alpha is less than beta. Whereas in this case, compared to this, alpha stretch ho gaya hai aur beta compress ho gaya hai. You can just compare the two and see, no? When you stretch it this way, this angle is becoming smaller when you go from this to this, and this angle is becoming larger. So here now alpha becomes less than beta. Square is a special case of rectangle, Tej. Yeah, where the sides are equal. So there not only alpha is equal to beta, but alpha is equal to beta equal to 45 degrees. Oh, sorry, my mistake. Here alpha is greater than beta. Here alpha is a larger angle and it's greater than beta, and also in the diagram label this correctly as alpha. Okay. So these two are two additional concepts to know. Okay, so these inequalities become something very key while solving certain types of questions. And the easiest way to keep them in mind is, instead of memorizing all these conditions that theta is less than 90, this happens, theta is greater than 90, this happens, just remember it in terms of visualizing these parallelograms. Karan, I will send you the recording later, which will have everything in detail. So we can go through the recording again, because repeating everything, because different people have network issues at different times. So like, I will send you the recording after the lecture today. Don't worry. Okay. So whichever part you missed, you can just go through. Okay, now let's understand some examples based on this. Tej, let's finish the parallelogram concept first, then we'll come to. Okay. So given that magnitude of the vector A, let us say 5, and magnitude of the vector B is 12, and the angle between them is obtuse. Okay, then which of the following is or are possible? Okay, which of the following is or are possible? Now I'll give you a whole lot of options here, okay, because we want to discuss many things here. Okay, so just try this out. Okay, so let's understand here. Obtuse means theta is greater than 90, less than equal to 180 degrees. Okay, so therefore, what is definitely happening is that this is the case, and magnitude of A plus B will be less than root of A square plus B square, but also at the same time greater than equal to this. Okay, so in other words, we can say that magnitude of A plus B is less than 13, but greater than equal to the difference of 5 and 12, that is 7. Okay, so therefore now we can see that which other options are possible. 12 is possible, okay, but this is not possible. Okay, and of course this is becoming wrong. Diti, we just discussed this now. See, we just discussed this above now. Theta is equal to obtuse case, kya hota hai? Oh, answers. Okay. I'll just verify. Okay. Nahi, Tej, it's not necessary it's equal to 180, na. It can be anything greater than 90, but less than equal to 180. So when it is equal to 180, then it will be mod of A minus B. No, so it can be 7. It can be larger than 7 also, but it cannot be 13 because it has to be less than 13. Understood? Na? So far your answers are correct, na, Diti. Now between 3 and 4, we have to select. Yeah, that's the formula based method, but I'm explaining by this method now. Okay, so, and what else we saw, that mod of A minus B becomes greater than root of A square plus B square whenever it is obtuse. So, but it is always less than equal to A plus B. Isse zyada to nahi ho sakta hai, na? Because theta equal to 180 case. Okay, so in this case, mod of A minus B has to be greater than 13. It cannot be equal to 13 also. Okay. But at the same time, it has to be less than equal to the sum of the two, which is how much now? What we have taken? 12 and 5. Na? So 17. Okay. So 17 ho sakta hai, but 20 nahi ho sakta hai for that reason. So which are the correct answers finally? So second, third, and sixth are possible. Okay. So the other way of solving this is by actually using the formula of triangle law. I'll explain that also, but that you'll see in comparison is very lengthy. We can avoid all that extra calculation if we just understand this from the triangle inequalities. So the formula based method is that magnitude of A plus B is root of okay. So here it will become 25 plus 144 plus how much is it? 120 cos theta. So that is square root of 169 plus 120 cos theta. Now we can see that theta is greater than 90 and less than equal to 180 degrees. That means cos theta is negative. Okay. And cos theta can be minus 1, but it cannot be 0. Okay. So then from this we can say that okay, mod A plus B, the minimum value of kitna hoga when cos theta is minus 1. So when cos theta is minus 1, it will be square root of 49 And when it is greater than, I mean, when it is
And likewise, you could write a formula for E minus B also, but it's going to become very lengthy. Like we have done this. Now, similarly, we could write a formula for E minus B also. But as I said, that's all is unnecessary. It's very lengthy. So that will become square root of 169 minus, how much was it now? 120 cos theta. Now you can see that cos theta is greater than equal to minus 1 but less than 0. So therefore you can see yes, Kunal, you have a doubt how 13 was less than E minus B. E, not less than beta. It's greater than E minus B. This one, no? Yeah. Is how we did this. Sorry, 289 minus. So Kunal, is it clear now, beta? No. Yeah, Diti, I'll come to the fourth option. Yeah, so in triangle inequality method, see what is happening. Whenever it is obtuse, A minus B is greater than root of A square plus B square. No? But overall, remember A minus B for any theta, for any angle theta A minus B
cannot be greater than difference of the two and cannot be larger than sum of the two. Okay, so combine this statement, which is for obtuse angle, with this one. So combining this and this tells you what, that when theta is obtuse, okay, your E minus B will be greater than root of A square plus B square, but it will be obviously less than equal to A plus B. Okay, so you must remember this global condition. Now, for any theta, ye to reh gayi, that, but along with this, now there is that additional condition. Okay. So now you combine this and this. So for theta being obtuse, mod of A plus B becomes less than root of A square plus B square, but obviously at the same time it cannot go on being less than, it has a lower limit, and that lower limit is the difference of the two. Okay, so this thing is important here. All right, so this is this kind of question. Now let's look at another example question, because there are lots of, you know, tricky kind of questions which are based on this, so one has to be careful. Start working this out, people. Not given. That's the thing, nah? So that's the thing about inequalities. There's always a lot of information which is based on assumption. But you can see they're not zero. You know, both the vectors are having some length. How much it is not given. Yes, that's correct, Diti. Yes, Hitanshu correct, Smriti correct. Very good. So all of you have understood this. So the main thing you have to concentrate is what is the angle between A and B. It is obtuse or it is acute. And you will see that it is an acute angle because the angle between them is 45 degrees. So to understand the angle, if it is getting too tricky, you can always do one thing. You can redraw the vectors from the origin, you know, rather than. So you draw the vector A over here now. Okay. So you can see that this angle is 45, and similarly redraw the vector B like this. Again, so yes, that's correct. So you can see that the angle between A and B, this angle theta is equal to 75 degrees. So it's less than 90. So obviously A plus B will be greater than A minus B, and because of that A plus B will be in general greater than root of A square plus B square, but less than equal to A plus B, and A minus B will be less than root of A square plus B square, but greater than equal to, I mean in this case greater than A minus B. Because it's not zero, no? The angle is not zero. The angle is in fact 75. So anyway, here only this option will be correct. This is wrong, this is wrong. This is wrong. So sums like this become easy to solve using the inequalities. And you will find plenty of questions like this, which are important in vectors. Okay, now moving on to the next of these special theorems and special inequalities and cases. So hope this question was clear to all of you. So the first one is a repeat of. Yeah, yeah, definitely. Exercise one, you can start working on the questions. Any question which is to do with sum and difference in exercise one, and not to do with dot product or cross product, you can now do. I think in exercise one, you can do up to question 22 or something like that. I'll check out and let you know. We will be discussing exercise one and two also. I mean, all the exercises, but very soon we'll start discussing questions from the exercise also. Okay. Yeah, the vectors chapter from that module, useful mathematics in physics. There is the module called useful mathematics of physics. So in that, the first chapter is vectors. So you can go through the chapter. The theory is similar to the notes that we are discussing here. And there are some in-chapter exercises. Okay, I'll resend the module on the greenhouse group. Anyway, so come back to this now. So the first special case is something that we've already seen. That is, if A is perpendicular to B. So I'll just write it quickly so that you understand. The parallelogram becomes a rectangle. So rectangle has the important properties that diagonals are equal and at equal angles with respect to sides. Okay, so this already we've discussed. So in terms of vectors, what happens is if theta is equal to 90 degrees, magnitude of A plus B is equal to magnitude of A minus B is equal to root of A square plus B square, and alpha is equal to beta equal to tan inverse B by A. We've already seen this. So just make a quick note of this if you're writing this down. That is a application of cross productage. We'll come to that later. You can also do by resolving components. Okay. Now let's come to the second case. Okay. If magnitude of the vector A is equal to the magnitude of the vector B, then what happens is that the parallelogram becomes a rhombus. Now this is the one we have to pay a lot of special attention to. A rhombus has a lot of special properties. We will discuss. Rhombus has the property that diagonals are perpendicular to each other. Okay. Secondly, the diagonals bisect each other. And third, the diagonals are angular bisectors. Okay. of the sides. So let us understand in context of vectors what this means now. So if this is our vector capital A, let's say of magnitude A, and this is our vector B, but also of magnitude A. So this side is becoming equal to this side. So when we complete the parallelogram, it should be a little bit longer. So anyway, okay. The shape we get now, we will be such that all four sides are equal. Okay. And therefore, when we draw the primary diagonal from the common origin to the opposite side, this now represents A plus B. And we also draw the secondary diagonal, which is from head to head. So if we draw from B to A, then remember it represents A minus B. Okay. Now the important properties come in, that because these four sides are equal, so these angles are 90. And this angle becomes equal to this angle. So it becomes theta by 2, because the original angle between the two vectors was theta. This was the common origin. Okay. And this angle becomes equal to this angle, and that becomes 90 minus theta by 2. Okay. So in terms of vectors, square is again a special case where theta is 90. So square is a, you know, combination of rhombus and rectangle. You can say square is a special parallelogram which is a rhombus as well as a rectangle. Okay. So in terms of vectors, it implies that the vector A plus B is perpendicular to the vector A minus B. So this is the first property, which is coming from this, that the diagonals are perpendicular to each other. Then alpha will be equal to theta by 2, and beta will be equal to 90 minus alpha or 90 minus theta by 2. So this is the second property. Okay. And there's one more property that will come from this, but by applying some trigonometry. So we'll come to that also. So just understand these first two things first. No, rhombus, the side angle is not 90 beta. Rhombus can be any, it's a kite shape, no? So rhombus can be like this also. The condition for rhombus is that four sides are equal, no? And the diagonals are at 90 degrees. This can be like this. These are all examples of rhombus. Now, square is a special case of rhombus. So, square is a rhombus, and at the same time, it's a rectangle also. Yes. The diagonals obviously make 45 degrees in case of square, you know that. Okay, sorry. So now there is one more special property. So first write it down and then we'll do the derivation. So whenever this happens that mod A is equal to mod B, we can also write a special formula that magnitude of A plus B becomes 2A cos theta by 2 and magnitude of mod A minus B becomes 2A sine theta by 2. Now just write down the formula first and then I'll show you in the diagram how it's very easy to show geometrically or prove geometrically why this formula happens. So all the three things that we've written here, they're very useful shortcuts while solving problems. Now these three things, they apply the moment what is happening, magnitude of A is equal to magnitude of B. So the parallelogram is a rhombus. So they'll apply to square also, but they'll apply not just to square, they'll apply to any rhombus where the sides are equal, the angle could be anything between the sides. Yeah, I'll explain. Now see, how did we get the last formula? So if you look at the rhombus over here, you can use the property that we discussed that the diagonals also bisect each other. So use this property, they bisect each other and they bisect each other perpendicularly. So when you use that, you'll understand that the diagonals actually cut the rhombus into four triangles, each of which are right angled and also congruent. So let's just go over the diagram carefully again. Understand that if the four sides are equal, so this angle is theta. Now what is happening is not only these are perpendicular, but these are also bisecting each other. So these two things are equal. Okay. This and this are equal. And these two angles are equal. That's the same as these angles. And that's the same as these angles. So you can see that we have four triangles, all of which are congruent and right angle triangles. So we have the diagonals bisect each other perpendicularly. Cut the rhombus into four congruent right angled triangles. So now in each of these triangles, let's say this side is x, this side is x, this side is y, and this side is y. So now concentrate on this right angle triangle. So you can see that x upon a will be equal to cos alpha or cos theta by 2. So x is becoming 2a cos theta by 2. Now magnitude of a plus b, you can see in the diagram, is 2x. So that implies that magnitude of a plus b is becoming 2a cos theta by 2. Okay. And similarly, in that same triangle, you can also see that y by a is sine alpha. And now just apply the same steps. So you can see that mod of a minus b is 2y. It becomes 2a sine theta by 2. So that is the proof of this thing. But for us, more important is that we can use this formula directly now. But remember, applicable when mod A is equal to mod B. The condition for this is that magnitude of A is equal to magnitude of B, equal to capital A. Yes, today's assignment will be the complete assignment 4. Plus, I will send you a list of questions to do from the module also. Yeah, I'll scroll up, but it's the same information. Alright, so this just this third property over here, okay, that is explained over here. So the four right angle triangles that I've shown, just apply trigonometry to any one of them, like this one. Apply trigonometry to this right angle triangle, this one here. You'll get this x by a, that is base upon hypotenuse. बिकॉज 2y है ना बेटा, अभी देखो वो डायगनल हाफ हाफ में कट हो रहा है ना, सो द रेड कलर डायगनल इज हाउ मच ट्वाइस ऑफ y, एंड द प्राइमरी डायगनल इज हाउ मच ट्वाइस ऑफ x. इट्स ऑल रिटन ओवर हियर बेटा, ऑल दी स्टेप्स आर रिटन, सी दिस स्टेप्स. Not theta beta, it's alpha. Alpha का value theta by 2 है. ध्यान से देखो वो triangle में. Where have I written theta? It's theta by 2 beta. देखो ना. just cross multiply here, na? So that's how we are getting this stage. Just cross multiply the a this side. So x is acha this one. Correct. This 2 should not be here. So this becomes 2a cos theta. Correct. This 2 should not be there. Yes, assignment 4 you have to be doing for the next lecture. So let's look at an example of application of this also. Yeah, this type of question you will see. Very standard type of questions. You will find in module, in assignment, everywhere. So just try this out now. No, Hitanshu, 45 degrees is not the angle. So see, if I go with this rhombus formula, this question becomes very easy to solve. So if I use the special rhombus theorem, and see that magnitude of A equals to magnitude of B. This implies that A plus B is perpendicular to A minus B, first of all. Okay. And alpha is equal to theta by 2, beta is equal to 90 minus theta by 2. But more importantly, this thing that A plus B has a magnitude of 2a cos theta by 2. So mod of a plus b is 2a cos theta by 2, and mod of a minus b is 2a sine theta by 2. Okay, because in the rhombus you know all these things happen. So now this ratio is given to me. This is given in the question. So now incorporate these formulae here. These formulae incorporate. See what you get. Okay. So incorporate those formula. So mod of A plus B upon mod of A minus B should become 2A cos theta by 2 divided by 2A sine theta by 2, and that is given as 1 by root 3. Okay, so see what you're getting from here. You're getting that cot of theta by 2 is 1 by root 3. Or you can say tan theta by 2 is root 3. So that means theta by 2 is tan inverse of root 3, which you know is 60 degrees, which means that theta is in fact 120 degrees, which should have been obvious because kya ho raha hai dekho, yahan pe mod of a plus b is less than mod of a minus b na. Because that ratio is 1 by, so theta had to be obtuse. So that too we had understood, but obtuse by how much? So now we understand that it's 120 degrees. Okay. So this is where the rhombus theorem comes in very handy. And now you can just, any other part also we need to calculate, just make use of this now. So theta is 120, that's done. Okay. And suppose we want to calculate mod of a plus b. That will become 2 into 10 into cos 60. So that is going to be 10. Whereas mod of A minus B is going to be 2 into 10 into sine 60. So that is going to be 10 root 3. And you can again check from that that the ratio is 1 is to root 3. And geometrically, you also understand this very easy because if you have two vectors of magnitude 10 each at 120 degree angle, you can see that the rhombus is in fact such that it can be broken into two equilateral triangles. Equilateral triangle ho jayega na, because the angle 60 hoga. So it's very obvious that A plus B will also be 10. So once you get this, it's very easy to justify it. It's this. Okay, and otherwise we have no option but to go to our standard method, which is formula based method, triangle law formulae. So mod a plus b becomes square root of 10 square plus 10 square plus 2 into 10 square cos theta, because a is equal to b is equal to 10, and mod of a minus b minus, let's make a correction here, okay, so all this lengthy mathematics has to be done. Okay. So then you have something like this. Okay. So square both the sides. Okay, and cross multiply and all that and solve, you'll get cos theta equal to minus half. So that will tell you that theta is equal to 120 degrees. Yeah, so that is why it's like a trick for solving these type of problems, you know. So the special cases of the parallelogram law become very important. Okay. You can also use component algebra, of course. You can also do this question by component algebra, but even that is lengthy. So that trick will always help. Now, the third and the final case of the special cases you should remember is when mod A is equal to mod B. Okay. And along with that, theta is equal to 90 degrees. So what happens is our parallelogram becomes that very special thing, which is the square. So square has both the properties of rectangle as well as rhombus. So in this case, all those properties hold. So mod A plus B becomes equal to mod A minus B. In fact, becomes equal to root 2 times A. Okay. Alpha becomes equal to beta becomes 45 degrees. And A plus B is perpendicular as a vector to A minus B. You can see these are the shared properties of rhombus and rectangle. Yeah, the second part is like you can just say now that the parallelogram formed by them will be a rhombus, so the diagonals are perpendicular. So that's this. Okay. So anyway, this is the third special case. So if magnitude of A is equal to magnitude of B, the shape you get is a square, and theta is equal to 90. This case. All right, people. So with this, we come to a conclusion for today's lecture. Okay. So I will be sending the assignment number 4 in your group, and I'll resend the module also because some of you apparently don't have it. So also some questions from the exercise 1 of the module and also in chapter exercises. But in general, the first 20 questions or so you can do. Okay. Yeah, I'll share the recording and the video. Don't worry. Okay. So anyway, so that's it, guys. All the best. See you next time. In between, if you have any doubts, you can always WhatsApp me. Okay.